resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and for gathering this community together today to be Jesus's hands and feet and voices in a broken and hurting world. We ask that you fill our hearts with your Holy Spirit as we leave this place and go out into your creation. We may bring the power of Jesus' resurrection to all of creation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Delivered us from the power of our enemy. Grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter began to speak to Cornelius and the other Gentiles. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. For God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The song appointed for today is Psalm 118. Please read it responsively. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. The right hand of the Lord has triumphed. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord has triumphed. The Lord has punished me sorely, but he did not hand me over to death.
Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter them. I will offer thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord. He who is righteous may enter.
I will give thanks to you, who has answered me, and have become my salvation.
The same stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. On this day, the Lord has acted. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Thank you.
reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you. Unless you have come to believe in vain, for I handed on to you as of first importance, which I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me, for I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have become, and so you have come to believe. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes, but Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent down to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord."
the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I always find the Easter Sunday gospel a bit amusing. I don't know if you do too. In various accounts of the resurrection story where Mary Magdalene is the first to encounter the risen Lord, she doesn't know who he is. She thinks he's the gardener. And Mary's quandary is in some respects shaped by her grief. It's hard when you're in the midst of grief to really see the world around you because you're so focused on this one thing that's consuming you. And so I think it's perfectly understandable and forgivable for Mary Magdalene not to recognize the risen Lord. And of course, we also have this story from 1 Corinthians about Paul being an apostle, but he's not one who actually knew Jesus when he was alive. Paul has his own deep experience of Jesus, which is probably unlike the experience anybody else has had. And he, too, is consumed with this one focus, which, of course, is persecuting the followers of Jesus, right? And yet he is transformed, too. He is pulled out of where he is to be able to see the Lord. And the stories that we hear throughout Easter time, because Easter, remember, despite what the secular world will tell us, it's not just one day, it's not just Easter morning. It's 50 great days of Easter. So we have this whole season to process what it means for Jesus Christ to be risen from the dead. And so we hear innumerable stories of Jesus' post-resurrection appearances to his disciples and their reaction to that. And does anybody remember any of the other stories that we hear about Jesus after he's risen from the dead? Any ones come to mind? You're churchy folks, right? You come to church. I know you come. Yes! All right, my man. Yes, you read my mind. So next Sunday, what we call Low Sunday, or Doubting Thomas Sunday. Thomas is another person who is very, very skeptical, even cynical, about the risen Lord. And I think even though people have a tendency to give Thomas a hard time, right, because, well, his faith must not be very strong, you know. He must be, you know, a bit dimmer than the rest. And yet, you'll recall that when Mary Magdalene first runs to the disciples on that morning that she's seen the risen Lord, they don't believe her either. And so even Jesus' closest, most intimate friends don't believe that he's risen, even though he told them, did he not? That this would happen in fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies. He alerted them ahead of time. Hey, this is going to happen. Watch out and pay attention. And yet they still don't see it. So it's not like it should have been a surprise. But what Jesus was proposing was so cataclysmic, so bewildering for human beings, because it's so outside the realm of our experience. Most of us, I don't think, I've ever seen anybody rise from the dead like Lazarus or Jesus. And yet at the same time, if we take the resurrection story to be more than just a story about a particular event in history, we think about what resurrection really means. Resurrection, as a wise friend of mine has said many times, the Reverend Sarah Augustal, she used to say, you know, resurrection does not mean restoration. It does not mean putting things back the way they were. Resurrection means transformation. Yes, new life, but in different vesture, right? It's different in appearance, it's different in feeling, it's different in experience. And so if Mary Magdalene or Thomas or the rest of the apostles and Paul were not able to perceive Jesus when he arrived, it's hardly any wonder, because he wasn't the same person as he was before the crucifixion. And the whole season of Eastertide, the 50 great days of Easter, is about recognizing Jesus anew, to be able to see Jesus in a new light, to be able to perceive our Lord in places perhaps where we're not used to seeing him, in ways that we're not used to seeing him. And the stories that we heard this morning are really meant kind of like Jesus alerting his disciples that, you know, let me tell you what's going to happen, right? This is going to happen. What he did not tell them was that you're not going to recognize it when it occurs. And I think there's a reason for that. I think it's because Jesus expects us to do the work. That is to say, it was Jesus' job to teach his disciples what they needed to know before he left them. But that doesn't mean that Jesus was going to spoon feed them. That part of becoming a mature follower of Jesus, whether it's the apostles or it's us, is learning to do some stuff on our own. Learning to apply what Jesus has taught us in new and creative ways. And that's the real test. It's not whether or not we were listening to Jesus or we come to church every Sunday and we hear these teachings and we hear preaching, we hear proclamation of the gospel and the other readings. But it's about knowing how to take those lessons and then apply them to our daily lives. And the entire season of Eastertide is really about the apostles learning to do that for themselves. You know, we hear a lot of readings from the Acts of the Apostles, and can anybody tell me what the Acts of the Apostles is? I'll start you out. It was written by the author of Luke, the Gospel of Luke. But what is the basic narrative of the Acts of the Apostles? Can anybody tell me? So the Acts of the Apostles is about the apostles learning to fend for themselves without Jesus. So you know the Acts of the Apostles begins with the ascension of Jesus, right? He spends some time with them, the 50 great days of Easter, teaching them again, appearing to them in a new form. And then he ascends to the Father, and then he's like, all right, well, you better figure it out, right? And what we have are the stories of those early first days of the church, when the church has to figure out how to organize itself, how to survive without Jesus being there to lead them by the hand. And they stumble a bit, and they're not quite sure, and they have to replace Judas, and they pick Matthias, forgotten apostle. And they decide that they need to, you know, share in the prayers, and they gather everything in common so that they can support the entire community with the resources of everyone, and they set aside certain people to look after the orphans and widows, right, when it comes to the origin of the diaconate, right? And then you see the disciples and the apostles going out into the world and proclaiming the good news. And the story of the good news is exactly what we heard from 1 Corinthians. It's basically a summary of the basic tenets of the faith. And I think that it's great that on a Sunday when we get people in church that we don't see necessarily all the time, that that's a good reminder of what the essentials of the Christian faith are. And as we spend the next 50 days hearing about how the disciples are trying to manage this awesome experience of the resurrection and the implications of that, we're also trying to figure that out for ourselves. We're trying to figure out how and where to see Jesus. And the apostles have a certain kind of advantage because the risen Lord is actually there with them. And he is recognizable, but not in the ways that they were accustomed to. And does anybody remember how Jesus is finally recognized in all those post-resurrection appearances? Road to Emmaus, right? Remember that? And also in today's gospel reading. Anybody know? Anybody tell me? Yes, so that's a great example of a post-resurrection story when doubting Thomas, he's like, you know, I'm not sure I believe this. And he wasn't there at the first appearance, right? The first resurrection, post-resurrection appearance. He has to wait for his chance to encounter the risen Lord. And Jesus invites him, put your finger into the wounds in my hands and in my side. And what does Thomas say in that moment when he does that? He goes,
my Lord and my God.
My Lord and my God. I don't know if any of you who were at the Easter Vigil last night, if you noticed that whenever the bishop consecrates and he offers up the bread, he says, my Lord and my God. offers up the cup, my Lord and my God, right? Kind of under his breath, quietly, as a recognition that it takes a direct encounter with Jesus sometimes to be able to proclaim that faith. And so Thomas requires some kind of empirical proof, which I think we all need. We would all like. But what Thomas, I think, and what Mary Magdalene, and what all of the disciples, I think, really wrestle with is how to encounter Jesus, how to know that Jesus is there when we don't have the proof in front of us. We have to take it on a certain amount of faith. And in our reading today, it's Mary recognizes him finally because he calls her by name. It's an intimate thing to be called by your name. Obviously, he knows her. He's not just a stranger. It's Mary, she says, Rabuni, teacher, right? And the same thing happens on the road to Emmaus, and we'll hear that story, where Jesus is walking, and he says, do you not know? And they say to him, do you not know what has happened in the last few days? And it's only when Jesus sits down with them and breaks bread with them and breaks open the scriptures that they're like, now I know who it is. Now I know who it is. Because it's not in necessarily Jesus himself that Jesus is recognized, not in the person that we knew before he died, right? It's not about restoration. It's about recognizing what Jesus did. That's the proof that Jesus is here. That Jesus called people by name, that Jesus broke bread with people as he had always done, whether they were outcasts and sinners or his most intimate friends, by his teaching. And in similar fashion, the way we will see Jesus and the way people will see Jesus in us is through those very same things, by breaking open the scriptures to people, to perpetuating and disseminating Jesus' teachings of love and justice and equity and mercy and the rest of it, by sitting down with people that we might not normally sit down with and break bread with them and be in fellowship with them. That's the way that people will see Jesus in the world. And the challenge for us is to be able to perceive Jesus in others, in the most unlikely places, in the most unlikely people. And yet Jesus is there if we would just attune our senses to be able to perceive him. Because Jesus is not going to appear to us as he did when he was going in and out of the world with his disciples. It's going to be known in the way we live our lives. Because what endure is not necessarily the bodily Jesus, although we have that in bread and wine, and we will share in that. But we will perceive Jesus, and people will perceive Jesus in the world by what we do and by living out his teachings. And that's, of course, what Jesus taught his followers. It's not about him, it's not a big ego, but he's not, he may have been a charismatic leader, but that's not what it was about. He was trying to teach them to fulfill God's commandments. The commandments that have always been and will always be, which is to love God and to love our neighbors as ourselves. And if we can do that, if we can do that out in the world, if we can do that for each other, then Jesus will always be present, no matter what he might look like or not look like. And we might see it in the face of a homeless person, or we might see it in somebody that we thought was a sworn enemy, or it might be in somebody who comes through these doors for the first time. And the challenge for us in Easter is to be able to live that out. And it's a hard road. And as I said, Jesus, I don't think, was trying to spoon-feed us, but to say, I'm going to give you my teachings and see what you do with them. Because that's the only way we will learn, is if we do it on our own. But as I often say, we don't have to do any of this work on our own. The whole reason the church exists, why community exists, is so that we can do that together. We can support each other as we do that work. And so as we go out into the world and preach the resurrection of Jesus, may we see Jesus in the faces of the least likely. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let us affirm our faith using the ancient words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man.
For our sake, he was
crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
My beloved siblings, for whom should we pray this day?
I'd like to pray especially for the repose of the soul of Barbara Satterthwaite, who passed away on Easter morning today.
Peace on the earth. That our works may find favor in your sight.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
And we give glory to your holy name.
Let light perpetual shine upon us.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Prosper the work of thy mission.
May we be generous in our support of the school and the mission's work.
We pray for it in God's lives.
Merciful God, bind up the wounds of all who suffer from gun violence.
Those maimed and disfigured, those left alone and grieving, and those who struggle to get through one more day.
At this time, anybody who would like laying on of hands and anointing for healing or a prayer for birthday, anniversary, travel, or other special attending can come to the altar. gracious God, we ask that you watch over this your servant. Send Cameron out into the world in peace. Help him to make his mark there. Help him to be your agent for healing and health and justice and mercy. Send them there. Send our love with him. And may you be with him all the days of his life, whatever pursuits he may encounter. Jesus' name we pray. Father, grant you the inward anointing of the Holy Spirit. Of his great mercy, may forgive you all your sins, release you from suffering, and restore you to wholeness and strength. Amen. O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. You are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer another one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Thank you.
Please be seated for the announcements, which I will keep blessedly short today since it's Easter Sunday and y'all have brunch to get to, I'm sure. So the first thing I want to say is how wonderful it is to see so many of you here. I want to thank everybody who made Holy Week a possibility. I know there's so many hands and efforts that went into it, thanks to the choir and Daryl and certainly the Altar Guild and Kurt and Greg. And I also want to say how much I enjoyed the Easter Vigil last night at the cathedral, and of course, how nice it is always to have a robust attendance by St. George of Barnabas. The only other announcement I think I have today is the Easter egg hunt for the kids after the service. Are there any other announcements? Oh, okay, sure. I also want to alert you, I've talked to some of you about this, but Barbara Satterthwaite passed away this morning. Barbara Satterthwaite, she was active in Daughters of the King and Altar Guild and the choir and so many. Pardon me?
She was a reader also.
A reader. Vestry, right. And so, fortunately, I got a call from her daughter on Thursday and was able to see her yesterday and give her last rites. And I don't know if I just got in under the wire or what often happens is that I think some people wait to go until they've had, either the last child flies in or you're able to get a priest there to do last rites. But she was ready to go, and as I prayed with the family and we were offering our prayers together, I said, I think it's so poignant that we should be anointing her for burial on the day that Jesus is in the tomb, right? And of course, she chose to pass on Easter morning when our Lord was raised from the dead, and if that isn't a sign of faith, I don't know what is. Amen? Amen. Amen. Yes, Greg. And also to let you know that Beatrice Cole is in the hospital again, and so I'm going to attempt to go see her. Beatrice Cole? Oh, you can't hear me? Can you hear me now? Okay. So Beatrice Cole is in the hospital too, so please pray for her and Antoinette and her family. Okay, go ahead. Go for it, Mr. Greg.
Also,
for the live stream, please.
I'm learning. There will be a second collection today. This is the fifth Sunday for our mission work. And also, just keep in mind, it's in the bulletin. I know sometimes we don't read the back page of the bulletin, but save the date. Men's Fish Fry, May the 17th. And more information will come as we go along with that.
Thank you, Greg. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts. We offer Christ's holy sacrifice for all those whom we see no more, but rejoice on us, with us in a distant shore and in a greater light, and particularly Barbara Satterthwaite. May their souls and the souls of all the departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace and rise in glory.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, and the calling of Israel to be your people, and your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father,
we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. We remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory.
offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, descend your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, blessed George, blessed Barnabas, blessed Cyprian, and blessed Philip, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
You take away the sins of the world.
The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof.
But speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you. eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord.
May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Rejoicing in the glory of the risen Lord, let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.